So, listeners, welcome to this conversation. I have a very special guest with me today, but before I introduce him, just a quick word on this format. As you know, ThinkTalent, has put out this short video format of conversations with business and HR leaders. And the idea is that it becomes a community resource for the whole HR and talent community to actually pick up on. And many of these will be available both on our website and on YouTube, etc. So it's a public resource which is being made available, and we are having conversations with a whole range of experts around talent and leadership. So today, as I said, I have a very special guest with me. So Mr. Vardarajan, Raja as he is called fondly. So Raja, welcome to the conversation, and thank you for making time. So Raja has worked across geographies, worked across industries. In fact, I always like to think of him as one of the early pioneers in the telecom industry in HR. He plunged in when a lot of people were still thinking, whether an HR job in telecom would be interesting enough or not. So he was one of the early pioneers and seen the industry getting shaped almost in a way for many, many long years. And again, he almost, if I may say, ended his corporate career as being the CHRO of Vistara, which again, airlines is a very, very interesting industry to be in. And he's been through many other industries, in between and throughout his career. But more important is that currently he works with a wide range of industries as a coach and as a consultant, and therefore has, I think, a perspective on talent which cuts across industry. And that's what I want to really have the conversation with you, Raja, about that, when you look at, cross-industry issues, because, HR heads in companies look at their own industry and typically look at issues which are very specific to industry. So maybe as I launch in, let me ask you this, when you do your consulting work and you worked across industries, if you take a perspective on talent, okay, what do you think are the basic things you would say to keep in mind when you are looking across industry? Where are the similarities? Where are the differences?
Thanks so much, Vimal, for this opportunity. I always believe very strongly that, the talent, as you call it, or the talent management, as you call it, is common across all industries.
Right.
I always have this word called admire, where you need to attract the right people, develop the right people, motivate them and retain them.
Right.
So, and if I look across industries, I'll risk and say that statistically significant difference does not exist. Hmm. In the way industry segments focus on talent,
right,
and what skill set they are looking at and what they bring into the organization, and many companies, make the mistake of looking for 100% fit for their role in their industry and thus look only at their own industry and restrict their entire talent pool rather than looking across industries to find out what sort of talent is available.
Right.
And also looking at saying that what is it available, can it be groomed to suit us? I'll give an example. Mm-hmm. When we're looking for people in the telecom industry, many were looking at the existing telecom industries. We looked outside and looked at multiple other allied industries and brought people in, from tower companies, from logistic companies, so that they could adapt and get into telecom.
Right.
Because you mentioned telecom, I was talking about the same thing happened in the outsourcing industry, in the ITS industry. People are looking at set skill sets. We said, can we look at different allied skill sets, bring them in so that you expand your talent pool and supply pool?
Right.
And that's how I see a lot of similarities in the way talent is looked at across organizations and across industries. Maybe the focus on, say, for example, in an ITS industry, the focus may be more on managing performance and retention, whereas in an aviation industry, the focus on more getting the right talent and then building a career for them in the organization, because it's very difficult to focus and get the right talent for the organization.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the nuances I see across industries, which I would say is very minimal in terms of how the talent is managed across industries.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so what you're saying is that in terms of the core HR, sort of the way of thinking about talent, it doesn't really change. But if there are, let's say, different talent management processes, the emphasis on a particular process could be a little bit more in some industry and on another process in some other industry a little bit, but not that much.
Agreed. There is a set of talent management processes, which I would say is the basics, which all of us have done right through the years.
Correct.
the focus on it, the weightage of it may change industry to industry.
Right.
You know, the other thing which I've seen is in the industry more when you're looking at a functional talent, maybe you look at more the in-depth of those functional talent right. which is required rather than the generic. But for the generic roles, it is, I would say, industry agnostic.
So, you know, if I just pick up that point, Raja, that, you know, increasingly, you know, there's a lot of discussion, certainly in India, if not abroad, about the fact that we have perhaps too many generalists and too few specialists. Okay. And if you, you know, and I'm not sure whether, you know, whether that's a fair comment or not, but certainly it's a comment you hear more often than not these days, right? Particularly when, you know, you're looking at technology talent and stuff like that. But what is your view on that? You know, like you rightly pointed out, you know, if people have got generic skills, they can cut across industries and perhaps some functions as well. But for specific functional talent or expertise kind of talent, are there different practices across industries or is it more or less the same?
No, what I have found is in many industries, the industry immersion happens right up front when a talent moves into the industry.
Right.
Especially so if the person is outside the industry.
Okay.
You know, for example, let me take my own example. I was not in telecom before I joined telecom.
Mm-hmm.
I actually had to go and get myself certified in a telecom 101
right.
before I started work in HR. Okay. Similarly, in aviation, I had to learn the basics of aviation and aviation 101
mm-hmm.
before I could start working and delivering on my role.
Right.
So to that extent, the industry immersion is a very critical aspect every industry goes through.
Correct.
Because everyone understands that the generic roles also need to know the industry specifics and the industry nuances.
Correct.
So that is one thing which I've seen across industries, be it in consulting. Why in consulting, when I moved from Pricewaterhouse, I had a different set of consulting practice. Mm-hmm. And I moved to KPMG, I had to go through the entire consulting certification once again.
Okay.
So it, the nuances are for their particular industry. Would you have the nuances to understand? Because if you look at HR, we always keep saying HR has to align to business.
Correct.
And if you don't understand the business, you cannot align HR. And we, you know, same thing is with every talent possible. When they move into an industry, it is necessary for them to have the overall view. On the terms of generalist and specialist, I think it depends upon individuals as well as industries. In some industries, the requirement for a talent acquisition is very, very critical.
Correct.
Okay, compared to the rest of the processes in talent. So those people tend to specialize in talent acquisition and talent, you know, getting and sourcing and everything, how to assess, how to ensure the right people get in, how to shorten it and improve productivity there.
Correct.
So to a certain extent, amongst the generalist role, they become a specialist as well.
Right, right.
For example, when I was in ITES, I focused a lot on talent acquisition.
Right.
Then only I moved into talent development in other areas because talent acquisition is the most critical part.
Correct.
In aviation, I was more looking at talent development and retention.
Right.
So the focus was more on that. And so I became an engagement, employment engagement specialist.
Correct.
So it depends upon the industry and what is the focus in that industry. And that automatically the person who is managing talent will start the specialization.
Correct.
I think one of the reasons why specialists have not been as successful in Indian companies till now it started picking up, but earlier was that cost was a factor. They didn't want to break up into a specialist role and a generalist role, saying that what will a generalist overall look at and what will a specialist look at. So these nuances were some sort of a issue, and that is maybe that's my opinion why it didn't pick up earlier stages.
Okay. Okay. No, that's an interesting, you know. So Raja, that, you know, brings me to, you know, maybe a slightly more philosophical question, if you will, right? So, you know, there are certain principles which have, you know, been established over many, many years around talent management, right? So when you look at these principles, and, you know, if I may give an example, so there is a principle, for example, around, you know, make and buy, and depending on which company and which industry you are in, you take a call saying, you know, do I want to make more or do I want to buy more, for example, right? But there are some certain guidelines you almost go with, kind of thing. Are you seeing any fundamental shifts in these principles, you know, around talent management?
I would say that there is, this has been happening. We've been talking about, you know, rising competition, talent crunch is not available in the market. Very much increased knowledge-based work. Yeah. Now the biggest threat of them all, COVID. I think organizations have started looking at how to stay competitive And managing talent is very critical for them, is their understanding the bottom line for them.
Correct.
So while the admire or the attract, develop, motivate, retain continues, in the last 1 year, I've seen some of the emergences. For example, there's been an increased focus on employee experience management rather than employee engagement management.
Right.
How does an employee experience his contact with the company? How does the employee experience each one of the processes which he or she gets in touch with? That is one thing I've seen in the industry. So, and linked to that is, I see a lot of importance is being given by the senior leadership to score similar to net promoter score, which a customer gives to an employee pre-promoter score, which is because based on employee experience, they want to understand ongoing basis on how their employees are feeling and wanting to retain them.
Correct.
So this leads to more, periodic feedbacks rather than an annual feedback from an employee. The touch points are increasing. One more thing I've seen is increased use of assessment tools to evaluate talent both at the hiring stage as well as at the identification of talent stage within the organization for movement, for career, for high potential. Lots of assessment tools have started getting increased because of, maybe it's because of pandemic, people don't look at it, or also looking at, can we create an unbiased way of looking at this? Also the, you and I are aware that performance management is undergoing a change.
Correct.
In the last few years, I have seen more of the bell curves giving way to continuous assessment of performance, being a continuous assessment rather than a year-end process. In the last 1 year, one more thing which is totally, which I've seen is focus on wellness.
Right.
Both physical and mental. Correct. Much more focus on that in the last 1 year, especially when the workforce is remote and people are not sure on how they are keeping up and coping up with what's happening to them.
Got it. Got it.
So these are some of the things which I see in the happening in the industry now.
So, a slightly different question, and you know, this is, see, there's a, both with COVID, but even before that, you know, there's a lot of discussion that, you know, the whole wave of digital was anyway around, and, you know, digitalization and all that, we had started talking about it, and, you know, it had taken some speed. Now people are saying it will get faster even more. And, you know, in that context, of course, people are saying that, or let me put this, there's a lot of discussion around technology talent.
Okay? Yeah.
I believe that there is not enough discussion happening around non-technology talent. Okay. And I'd certainly like to hear what are you experiencing around you.
Look, I think it's, I agree that rapid automation, technology, augmented intelligence is all the way of the future. But to have, I always say that the artificial intelligence comes from the human being and artificial comes from the machine learning. Now, if you don't focus on the human element, I call it the non-technical element, you will not be able to create the right technical solutions. So to that extent, I believe that there is a lot of need for focusing on the non-tech capabilities and talent in the across the industries.
Right.
If you look at any industry, product differentiation or capital differentiation can easily be bridged very fast.
Correct.
But it's especially, for example, in ITS, telecom and airlines where I used to work, the biggest differentiating factor which we brought in was the customer responsiveness and the customer service.
Correct.
You can't build this with tech capabilities. While you can build the connecting time and response, you know, of the technology to it, but the person who's responding to the person has to have the non-tech capability. That's why I see a lot more focus on learnability, which is coming into the being. Whether I can get the people to learn more and much faster, especially keeping the remote working in mind and the remoteness in mind.
Correct.
How fast can they embrace technologies? That is a human element to it. How can a person adapt much faster and be flexible in the way he or she does things?
Right.
And ability to connect dots and see patterns and trends even when there's no pattern. Because if you look at the pandemic and how what it has created, it's created innovation in us.
Correct.
It's created a lot of things which we have never done before.
Absolutely.
The other focus, in spite of focusing on tech capabilities, is the collaboration and networking. I always find that is a major issue when it comes to people who focus only on, say, programming or coding, the collaboration and networking element is missed out, and that is critical to look at. And the basic of them all is how humble the person is and how curious the person is. Because that is what is going to help them innovate and grow. And that is what I look at as what is required in the non-tech areas. And of course, you know, it's beaten to death. Design experience or design mindset is something which people need to have.
Now, that's interesting because, you know, all of these capabilities you've spoken about, Raja, and, you know, add to that, if I add, you know, people are now talking about resilience and, you know, the ability to fail fast and all that sort of stuff. So you know, so these are all actually, you know, in a way, nothing to do with technology, you know, in that sense, right? So it'll be interesting to see. But, you know, you spoke about assessments and it'll be, you know, just maybe a quick word on that. Are you seeing that companies are doing enough assessment on these capabilities, you know, things like adaptability, flexibility, learnability, you know, some other things you spoke about?
I see this happening at a senior level more than the middle and junior level.
Okay.
You know, people use different tools and psychometric instruments to understand the person a little bit more deeper.
Right.
And at the entry level or the even the first level supervisor level. And I believe very strongly it's very critical in that level too. Because that is the level where you get a people, the person starts getting groomed into middle level and senior level roles. But I don't see much of that happening in terms of the assessment of some of these skill sets in the middle and junior levels.
Okay. Yeah, that's interesting.
I see it more at the senior levels.
Although it's interesting, you know, because one could take a view and, you know, this is a debate I was having with somebody a few days back that, you know, by the time a person is senior, he or she has already built certain habits.
You're right.
And, you know, maybe the right time, as you pointed out as well, is to start early enough because, you know, these capabilities have to be built over a period of time, you know, rather than...
I agree. And what happens is at that point of time, you're trying to manage the person rather than develop the person.
Right.
You know,
right.
The difference between the middle level, junior level, you develop. But at a senior level, it's more of the stuck, you know, and you're trying to manage.
Correct. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, if I go back, Raja, to where we started around, you know, and as we come towards the later part of this conversation or the end of this conversation, you know, what would you say? So if I were a, you know, and you do because you do a lot of coaching and consulting work. So if I were a HR manager or a HRCR, when I say HR manager, a CHRO, and I have to move across, you know, industries or across companies in different industries, and look at talent, what are the 2-3 questions I should be asking as I move from company A in industry A to a company B in industry B? You know, what are the top 3-4 questions I should be asking from a talent management perspective?
If I was a candidate being interviewed from different industries, okay, the first thing I'd like to understand from any employer is what is their, how agile they are, you know, in terms of meeting with differences and meeting with different situations.
Right.
How are they agile and what do they do on that? Okay, that is one thing which I'd like to understand. Yes, I would like to understand about what technologies and tools they use across the organization so that it gives me a feeling of comfort whether I will be able to adapt to that or not.
Got it.
The other thing which I look at is how do they look at productivity? Is it a task-oriented organization or is it a combination of task and, you know, people orientation.
Interesting.
And the other thing which I'll also look at is how do they engage with their employees? How do they engage with people? Because more and more I find remoteness and work from home being a part of their job.
Correct.
So how are they geared to meet with that? And what is that they're doing? Fourth is, what is their way of looking at careers and growth? While I don't want them to promise me promotion every year, second year, I would like to understand the process by which they identify the talent,
correct,
the process by which they look at talent for growth and development.
Right.
You know, these are some of the things which I look for in an organization when I get in. Yes, of course, the growth trajectory, what is the company business and all that is something which I will look at.
Yeah, but that's an interesting perspective you bring, Raja, that, you know, if I'm an HR person, then if I can answer some of these questions for a prospective employee, if you will, or even an existing employee, actually, that's a nice hack to wear, that you almost say that, okay, leave my HR shoes, let me get into employee shoes and see what questions he or she has. And if I can, you know, and obviously, like you said, you know, it will change from company to company and possibly industry to industry, but perhaps not that much. But thank you for, you know, those tips and any last comments you think, anything else which, you know, we've left out in this conversation?
Look, I think for anyone to succeed or any HR person to succeed at this point of time, I think we need to have a mindset by which we clearly say that nothing is common, nothing is steady, nothing is rigid. Okay. I think we need to constantly rethink our way of roles and definition of workforce, look at, you know, be agile in your mind so that you can adapt to situations. I think the present pandemic has created such a mindset in a lot of people.
Right.
And we need to ensure that when we even go into technology and machine learning, we need to constantly be aware that the biases which we carry are not taken into the technology. That's something which we need to be worried about and be careful about.
Right, right.
And I believe very strongly that because machine learning and AI is the future, that's one thing which we need to be cautious about.
Right, right.
No, great. Thank you, Raja. That's a lovely conversation. And as usual, it's great to have a conversation. You know, it sparks a few things and a few ideas. And I'm sure for the listeners for this video also, there'll be some interesting thoughts and reflections from this conversation. So thank you for making time for this. Really,
it was a pleasure. Pleasure was mine, Bimal. And it's always good to share thoughts with you.
Thank you.
Thank you.